they're not essential. You can have a wedding literally without any of those things. But I want you to think about one other thing that's going to be a part of the ceremony today, and that's the vows. The vows that you're going to make. It's a funny thing. A lot of people give a lot more consideration, thought, and planning to the whole wedding ceremony more than they do the vows. And all the other things you really could do, or you could have a wedding without those. But here's the truth. This is what a wedding is. A wedding is a vow. Everything else is disposable. In fact, Walter Raymond puts it this way. He says, marriage begins with a promise. A man and a woman stand in a church, in a chapel, on a platform, or in a garden, or in a backyard before each other, before witnesses and before God who created them, and they make a vow. They make a promise. They give their word. A promise offered, a promise received, a promise witnessed, a promise kept. See, that's where marriage begins. And folks, that's what makes a marriage. A marriage, it doesn't start with feelings. A marriage, this may even surprise you, it doesn't necessarily start with love. It doesn't begin with physical intimacy, although there's a lot of confusion about that in our day. Marriage does not begin when emotional needs start getting met. Marriage starts with a promise. And you know, when you really think about this promise, the time frame of this promise, it is absolutely staggering. Because a man and a woman stand in front of each other before witnesses and before God, and they say, I promise you this as long as, not as long as it's expedient, not as long as you keep making me happy, not even as long as you love me back, not even as long as it's easy. It's as long as we both shall live, till death do us part. And you know, that's why, to me as a pastor, a wedding is such a moving and wonderful, but yet a frightening thing in the sense of it's a lifetime deal. It really is a lifetime deal. But that makes it a joyous thing either, also, because then you get to go on an adventure. But it's a promise that you're going to make of no matter what happens kind of promise. And it's about as close as two finite human beings get to what God does for us when the Bible says he makes a covenant with us, a vow of unfailing, unending, no matter what kind of love. So a man and woman stand before each other and they give their word. Here in this world, where there's so much change, where there's so much uncertainty, so much unpredictability, so much undependability, and now, when that promise is made, there's this one little oasis of certainty. There's this one unalterable truth that you can bet your heart on for the rest of your life. For better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, for sickness or health, you can count on this promise. I give you my word. This is my solemn vow kind of promise. And this leads to a very important question. What exactly are you committing to when you make this promise? What is it that you are precisely promising each other that you're going to do till death do you part? Because you can't promise everything. But here's what the promise is about. The writer of scripture in the book of Genesis chapter 2 says, it is God's intent in marriage that a man should leave his father and mother, be united to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. The two become one. In a phrase, you're promising to pursue oneness. A unique, committed oneness with one other human being. Oneness of heart, oneness of mind, oneness of spirit, oneness of soul, oneness of knowing each other, oneness of serving each other, oneness of mutual submission and mutual accountability, and building a life and family together. The two shall become one, and give your word, and give your vow. That's what makes a marriage. So today, before God and these witnesses, the thing that matters most is the covenant promise that you're about to make. So Clarke, Caitlyn, the covenant which you're about to make with each other is meant to be a beautiful and a sacred expression of your love for each other. As you pledge your vows to each other, as you commit your lives to each other, we ask that you do so with all seriousness, and yet with this deep sense of joy and delight, with the deep conviction that you are committing yourself to this dynamic, growing relationship of trust, mutual support, and caring love. So if it's still your desire to enter this sacred covenant, I want you to join hands. You guys have thought a lot about your vows. In fact, you've done such a great job of thinking about them that you have written your own vows today. So if you will repeat those to each other at this time, Clarke.
So I am looking forward to this gift.
To have and
to hold
from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, to do whatever you tell me to do. This is my soft spot. Okay, I'll do that.
Hi, Caitlyn.
Thank you, Clarke.
Be my wedded
husband.
To be my
wedded husband. To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
From this moment, I have been blessed. The wedding ring is a symbol of eternity. It's an outward sign of an inward and spiritual bond that unites two hearts in endless love. And now, as a token of your love and your deep desire to be ever forever united in heart and soul, Clarke, take this ring, place it in the ring, finger of your bride, repeat after me. Caitlyn, I give you this ring as a symbol of my love